Hello. Welcome to the lecture on the structure of the Indian judicial system. This comes within the module on judicial process. The basic objective is to understand the structure of the union judiciary and state judiciary in India. Keywords in the lecture are Supreme Court of India, High Court, subordinate judiciary, tribunals, Constitution of India, jurisdiction, original, appellate, writ, contempt of court, and special leave petition. India has a unitary judicial structure with the Supreme Court, High Courts, and Lower Courts constituting a single unified judiciary, having jurisdiction over all cases arising under any law, whether enacted by Parliament or a state legislature. The Supreme Court is the apex court of the land, and every High Court is the apex court of the respective state. This structure is in contrast to a dual system of courts, such as in the US, which has a federal judiciary, with the Supreme Court at the top, along with a separate and parallel judicial system in every state. This means that every state in the US has its own Supreme Court. This distinction between the federal judiciary and state judiciary creates a demarcation, in that each cannot deal with matters falling within the jurisdiction of its counterpart. The objective of this lecture is to familiarize the student with the following: the structure of the Indian judiciary, the different bases of jurisdiction, the powers exercised by each rung of the judiciary, and the issues and controversies that have arisen in the exercise of such powers. We will begin with the Union Judiciary. The Union Judiciary is singularly composed of the Supreme Court of India, which is established under Article 124 of the Constitution as the highest constitutional court of the land and guardian of the Constitution. The Supreme Court is presently composed of 31 judges, including the Chief Justice of India, who sit in smaller benches of 2 or 3 judges, known as a division bench, or in larger benches of 5 or more judges, known as a constitution bench, only when required to settle fundamental questions of law as to the interpretation of the constitution. We will examine the different jurisdiction and powers exercised by the Supreme Court. The first important jurisdiction is the writ jurisdiction under Article 32. Article 32 constitutes the Supreme Court as the protector and guarantor of fundamental rights by conferring it with the power to enforce them. As such, the writ jurisdiction is an integral part of the basic structure of the Constitution. Clause 1 guarantees the right to any person whose fundamental right has been infringed to move the Supreme Court to enforce the same. Therefore, the provision can only be invoked when there is an infringement of a fundamental right. In order to enforce a fundamental right, judicial review of administrative, legislative, and governmental action or non-action is permissible. However, Article 32 cannot be invoked merely to adjudge the validity of any such action. While considering a petition for enforcement of a fundamental right, the Supreme Court can declare a legislation to be ultra vires or beyond the competence of the enacting legislature. As long as there is an infringement of a fundamental right, the petitioner need not prove the exhaustion of all local remedies or the absence of any adequate alternative remedy, which are characterized more as policies of convenience rather than rules of law. Having said this, there have been a few exceptional cases where the Supreme Court has entertained writ petitions not involving any fundamental right on the ground of the issues assuming great constitutional significance, requiring authoritative determination by the Supreme Court, and the absence of any alternative mechanism for the Supreme Court to take cognizance of the matter. The Supreme Court is not bound to follow the ordinary adversarial procedure under Article 32 and may adopt such procedure as most effective to enforce the fundamental right. The Constitution is deliberately silent on this aspect in order to prevent procedural technicalities from hindering the enforcement of fundamental rights and to preserve the Supreme Court's discretion. The Supreme Court has employed this discretion for the benefit of weaker sections of society by allowing relevant material to be adduced through non-conventional sources, such as letters, as well as by appointment of commissioners to gather facts and data, particularly seen in the realm of public interest litigation. Likewise, the matter of locus standi under Article 32 lies within the realm of the Supreme Court. Over a period of time, the Supreme Court has taken a liberal view of this requirement and has come to adopt a flexible view on a person's entitlement to approach the court under this provision. Accordingly, it is not necessary that the victim of the violation of the fundamental right should personally approach the Supreme Court for redress, as the Supreme Court can itself take cognizance and proceed suo motu or upon a petition filed by any public-spirited person, who may be a natural person or a legal person, again, which is seen in public interest litigation. The other liberal dimension supplied by the Supreme Court is the power it has implied to award damages or compensation. Thus, the Supreme Court has fashioned its power under Article 32 as not only injunctive but also remedial in character in order to maximize the efficacy of the provision. The Supreme Court also enjoys discretion in the matter of the relief to be granted. Clause 2 specifies the writs the Supreme Court may issue. The first writ is habeas corpus. This is used to secure release of a person who has been detained unlawfully or without legal justification. The second writ is the writ of mandamus. This is used to command a public authority to perform a public duty belonging to its office. The third writ is the writ of prohibition. This is used to restrain completion of proceedings. The fourth writ is quo warranto. This is used to call upon the holder of a public office to demonstrate to the court the authority under which he is holding the office. The fifth writ is the certiorari writ. This is used to quash a decision taken by a lower tribunal when it has acted without or in excess of its jurisdiction, or when there is an error apparent on the face of record, or when findings of facts are not based on evidence, or when the principles of natural justice have been violated, or when any fundamental right has been violated, or when the law under which it has acted is itself unconstitutional. The Supreme Court can frame writs to suit the exigencies of a particular situation and cannot dismiss a petition merely because an incorrect writ has been sought for. The Supreme Court retains the discretion to decide disputed questions of fact if it so desires, although it ordinarily refrains from doing so. Article 32, being a fundamental right, itself cannot be diluted or whittled down by any legislation. However, the principles of res judicata and latches, which refers to inordinate delay, have emerged as important self-imposed limitations to this jurisdiction. The second important jurisdiction is the contempt of court jurisdiction conferred by Article 129. Article 129 establishes the Supreme Court as a court of record, entitling it to preserve its original record in perpetuity. By virtue of being such a court, the Supreme Court has the power to determine any question about its own jurisdiction and also has the inherent jurisdiction to punish summarily for contempt of itself as the highest court of record and of any high court, subordinate court, or tribunal as a court exercising appellate and superintending powers. This jurisdiction is of a special nature. It is designed to preserve the dignity and integrity of courts and majesty of law, enable administration of justice according to law in a regular, orderly, and efficacious manner by ensuring and enforcing compliance with orders and directions of courts, and empowers courts to inflict punishment for lapses in the same. The jurisdiction contemplated under the Constitution is inalienable and cannot be taken away or diluted by any legislation short of constitutional amendment. It is for this reason that the provisions of the Contempt of Courts Act 1971 are in addition to and not in derogation of the constitutional sanction. Contempt proceedings are quasi-criminal in nature, taking place between the state and alleged contemner, which are either initiated suo motu by the Supreme Court or upon an application by a party, who may be a private person or a subordinate court. The litigation is not, strictly speaking, adversarial in nature, as the party notifying the court of the alleged contemnatious conduct does not have the status of a litigant. In summary, the Supreme Court ought to proceed by way of contempt only when there is real prejudice which can be regarded as a substantial interference. It is an extraordinary power which must be exercised sparingly and when demanded by public interest. It is important to note that in contempt proceedings, the Supreme Court's only concern is compliance with and not correctness of the earlier decision. The third important jurisdiction is the original jurisdiction to determine intergovernmental disputes under Articles 131 and 131A. Article 131 stipulates conditions under which the Supreme Court exercises original jurisdiction. In other words, when it is the first and only forum enjoying exclusive jurisdiction. This jurisdiction is triggered when there is a dispute between the central government and one or more states, or the central government and any state and one or more states, or between two or more states. This is the first condition. The second condition is that the dispute must involve a question of law or fact determining the existence or extent of a legal right as distinguished from a political right, such as questions involving the validity of a central or state law, competence under Schedule 7 of the Constitution, among other questions. The third important condition is that the question must not be one accepted by the proviso to Article 131 or any other provision of the Constitution. Under Article 131, the Supreme Court has the power, authority, and jurisdiction to pass any order or issue any direction as may be found necessary for the ends of justice, since the original jurisdiction has been conferred under special circumstances and for special reasons. Article 131A confers exclusive jurisdiction on the Supreme Court in respect of questions as to the constitutional validity of central laws. The fourth jurisdiction of the Supreme Court is the appellate jurisdiction under Articles 132, 133, 134, and 136. The Supreme Court is the highest court of appeal, and its appellate jurisdiction can be classified as follows. First, appeals on constitutional questions by the certificate of the High Court under Article 132, subclause 1. The Supreme Court can hear appeals involving the interpretation of the Constitution arising out of any proceeding in a High Court, civil, criminal, or other, provided the High Court certifies to this effect. A certificate may be granted only if 1. The case involves a question of law as to the interpretation of the Constitution, an important inclusion in the certificate, for then the appeal will be heard by a Constitution bench of 5 judges or more. 2. The said question is substantial, which in this context refers to a question on which there is a division of opinion. And 3. The applicant was a party to the case before the High Court. Appellants are not entitled to challenge the propriety of the decision appealed against on a ground other than that on which the certificate is granted, except with the leave of the Supreme Court. Now there are appeals not involving constitutional questions. One such appeal is appeals from civil proceedings by certificate of High Court under Article 133, subclause 1. The Supreme Court can hear appeals from a judgment, decree, or final order in a civil proceeding in a High Court if the High Court certifies that 1. The case involves a substantial question of law of general importance, and 2. In the opinion of the High Court, the question needs to be decided by the Supreme Court. A substantial question of law is one on which there exists or which affords scope for difference of opinion. When there is divergence of opinion amongst the High Courts, the fact that the rulings of the High Court from which appeal to the Supreme Court is sought are uniform, or that there is no direct decision of that High Court, does not prevent the question from being a substantial question of law. On the other hand, if there is no divergence of opinion amongst the High Courts on a point of law, the mere fact that there is no decision of the referring High Court on the point will not convert it to a substantial question of law. However, the substantial question of law under this provision must be of general importance, which means that apart from the parties to the litigation, the general public should be interested in the determination of the question. One such example of such a question is the distribution of legislative powers between the Union and states. The High Court must be satisfied that the question needs to be authoritatively decided by the Supreme Court, the word needs suggesting that some imperative necessity must arise from the facts and circumstances. The certificate is not conclusive as to the right to appeal, and the Supreme Court retains the discretion to refuse to entertain the appeal if it finds that the requirements of the provision have not been met. Further, the Supreme Court does not ordinarily interfere with findings of fact that have become final or those that are concurrent, unless facts and circumstances compel it to do so, such as when there has been a miscarriage of justice. The Supreme Court may grant leave to the appellant to raise a question of law not covered by the certificate. Another appeal which does not involve a constitutional question is appeal from criminal proceedings under Article 134, Subclause 1. The Supreme Court can hear appeals from any judgment, final order, or sentence in criminal proceedings in a High Court. Under Clauses A and B of the provision, an appeal lies as a matter of right to the Supreme Court on both questions of fact and of law. Accordingly, the Supreme Court is empowered to arrive at its own conclusion as to the guilt of the accused and examine evidence only to the extent necessary to assess the correct application of principles by the High Court. Conversely, an appeal under Clause C of the provision does not lie as a matter of right. It is instead subject to the grant of a certificate of fitness to appeal by the High Court. The Supreme Court will not reassess any evidence or argument on a point of fact in the absence of any compelling reason, exceptional circumstance, or gross miscarriage of justice. The certificate must be granted sparingly and in exceptional or special circumstances to ensure that high courts are ordinarily the final courts of criminal appeal and that the Supreme Court is not converted into an ordinary court of criminal appeal. The High Court must determine the issue of law or principle which in its opinion needs to be settled by the Supreme Court, and such question must be apparent on the face of the certificate. The correctness or propriety of the decision or order has no bearing in the determination. Although general importance is not a mandated condition under Article 134, a certificate can only be issued when there is some error of fundamental character and the only or primary question involved is not of fact or appreciation of evidence. A denial of a certificate under this provision does not preclude a party from applying to the Supreme Court for special leave to appeal under Article 136. Appeal by special leave of Supreme Court under Article 136 is another type of appeal not involving a constitutional question. The Supreme Court enjoys a special plenary appellate power for due and proper administration of justice by virtue of the discretion conferred on it by Article 136 to interfere in suitable cases. The Court has the power to grant special leave to appeal from any judgment, decree, determination, sentence, or order in any cause or matter passed or made by any court or tribunal in the territory of India. The provision does not confer a right of appeal on any party and does not prescribe any limitation as regards locus standi. The power is to be exercised very sparingly, with care, caution, and circumspection, and only when special circumstances are shown to exist. Further, this extraordinary jurisdiction cannot be barred or limited by any legislation short of constitutional amendment. The jurisdiction can be triggered upon the filing of a petition asking for special leave to appeal, which is known as a special leave petition or SLP, or by a suo motu exercise of power by the Supreme Court when it is satisfied that compelling grounds exist. The exercise of jurisdiction consists of two steps. First, granting special leave to appeal, and two, hearing the appeal. The Supreme Court's discretion at the first stage continues to the second stage. Therefore, it may declare the law or point out the lower court's error, but still refrain from interfering if special circumstances are not shown to exist. The standards governing the exercise of the Supreme Court's discretion under this provision has been the subject of much adjudication before the court. The court has repeatedly pronounced that its discretionary power is plenary in that the provision opens with a non-obstantive clause and the power is not preceded with any qualifying words. However, the exceptional power is to be exercised sparingly and only in furtherance of the cause of justice, when a question of law of general public importance arises or a decision sought to be impugned shocks the conscience of the court. Many constitution benches have cautioned that Article 136 cannot convert the Supreme Court into a tribunal or a court merely settling disputes and reducing itself into a regular court of appeal. Notwithstanding repeated pronouncements to this effect, the Supreme Court itself has observed its tendency to redeem justice in individual cases under Article 136, despite the clear constitutional overtones that this jurisdiction is only intended to settle the law. Although the Constitution Bench has observed that a more or less uniform standard should be adopted in granting special leave, this has not materialized in practice. The Supreme Court has expressed its difficulty in prescribing a formula or rule to guide the exercise of its power. The barrage of cases under Article 136 and the consequent compounding of the already clogged dockets of the Supreme Court has not escaped the court, time and again warning that Article 136 cannot open the floodgates of litigation. In fact, the Supreme Court has even recommended the constitution of a Constitution Bench to lay down broad guidelines to direct the exercise of discretion under Article 136. Another important jurisdiction of the Supreme Court is its review jurisdiction under Article 137. Article 137 envisages the Supreme Court to review any judgment pronounced or order made by it subject to the provisions of any law made by Parliament or any rules made under Article 145. In appropriate cases, the Supreme Court may pass an order ex debitio justitiae by correcting mistakes in the judgment. However, these inherent powers can be exercised only when there is no other existing provision in that behalf. The power of review is not tantamount or equivalent to appellate power, which means that the original matter cannot be reheard or the errors of the lower court cannot be remedied. A review petition must be filed within 30 days from the date of the judgment or order sought to be reviewed and must clearly set out the grounds for review. Review jurisdiction must be exercised with extreme care, caution and circumspection in only exceptional cases and in observance of the grounds of review stipulated in Order 40 of the Supreme Court Rules 1966, drafted under Article 145, Subclause 1E. According to these rules, review of a judgment in a civil proceeding is confined to the grounds mentioned in Order 47, Rule 1 of the Code of Civil Procedure 1908. Review of a judgment in a criminal proceeding is confined to the ground of error apparent on the face of record. Therefore, if a reasoning of a judgment sought to be reviewed is at variance with clear and simple language in a statute, then the judgment suffers from a manifest error of law, which is an error apparent on the face of record and is therefore liable to be rectified. Having said this, in a recent landmark judgment in Muhammad Arif versus the Registrar, Supreme Court of India, the court clarified two very important facets of its power of review. First, notwithstanding the difference in phraseology, in Order 40, Rule 1 of the Supreme Court rules, it equated the scope of the power in civil and criminal proceedings, stating that the purpose of the power is plain and the interpretation of the power must naturally be expansive. Second, it carved out an exception to the bar on oral hearings in Order 40, Rule 3 for death penalty cases, holding that the fundamental right to life is the paramount factor which cannot be compromised at any cost. Therefore, a limited oral hearing even at the review stage is mandated by Article 21 in all death sentence cases. Even after the dismissal of a review petition, a curative petition can be filed under the Supreme Court's inherent power seeking review of a decision which has become final after such dismissal on very strong grounds, such as variation of the principle of natural justice, question of bias, and abuse of process of court. The Supreme Court also has the power to do complete justice under Article 142, Subclause 1. This confers a plenary jurisdiction on the Supreme Court to pass any decree or make any order which is necessary for doing complete justice in any cause or matter pending before it, civil or criminal. The provision is conceived to meet situations which cannot be effectively and appropriately addressed or resolved within the existing framework of law. For instance, the power can only be exercised when the Supreme Court is otherwise exercising its jurisdiction. It is vital that the order is necessary to administrate complete justice. Having said this, the Supreme Court has demonstrated an inconsistent attitude as regards the scope of the provision. On some occasions, it has categorically prevented Article 142 from supplanting statutory provisions unless equity and absolute necessity demands otherwise. On other occasions, it has alluded to its power under this provision being on an entirely different level to ensure complete justice and thus which cannot be curtailed by ordinary laws. Another important jurisdiction of the Supreme Court is its advisory jurisdiction under Article 143. This empowers the President to consult and seek the opinion of the Supreme Court upon any question of public importance as the President may think fit, whether of law or fact, which in his estimation has arisen or is likely to arise. The President can only refer a question of law which has not been decided by the Supreme Court. Under Clause 1 of the provision, the Supreme Court retains the discretion to decline to express any opinion on the question submitted to it, such as when the question referred is political in nature or is incapable of being answered or is vague or hypothetical. Similarly, the President is not obligated to act upon the opinion delivered by the Supreme Court. However, if the Supreme Court does express an opinion, the Executive cannot request the Supreme Court to revise its decision as the advisory jurisdiction is not tantamount to appellate jurisdiction of the Supreme Court over its own decisions. However, under Clause 2 of the provision, it is obligatory for the Supreme Court to entertain a reference and deliver its opinion to the President. An advisory opinion is generally understood to be binding on all lower courts. The Supreme Court, however, remains free to re-examine and, if necessary, overrule its opinion. However, since it is not a judgment, an advisory opinion does not furnish a good root of title. The Supreme Court also enjoys additional jurisdiction under Articles 138, 139, and 140. We will now proceed to understand the state judiciary. The state judiciary consists of a high court and a system of subordinate courts. We will begin with the high courts. Article 214 establishes a high court for every state as the apex court in the state judicial system. Parliament may, however, establish by law a common high court for two or more states under Article 231. Presently, the 24 high courts, with the following states having a common high court: Punjab and Haryana, Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, and Assam, Nagaland, Mizoram and Arunachal Pradesh, which come under the Guwahati High Court. Within a state, a High Court may sit in different benches in different cities. The Supreme Court and High Courts are constitutionally independent of each other as both are courts of record. The High Courts are not subordinate to the Supreme Court except for the purposes of the Supreme Court's appellate jurisdiction, in which context the High Courts exercise an inferior or subordinate jurisdiction. Unlike for the Supreme Court, the Constitution does not contain detailed provisions outlining and defining the jurisdiction of high courts. Article 225 maintains the status quo existing on the date when the Constitution came into force in respect of the jurisdiction and powers of high courts subject to provisions of the Constitution and any law made by the appropriate legislature in pursuance of its constitutional powers. This is because high courts had been in existence much before the advent of the Constitution and are institutions of respectable antiquity. The first important jurisdiction of the High Court is its contempt of court jurisdiction under Article 215. Like the Supreme Court, High Courts too are courts of record and have all powers of such a court, including the inherent power to punish for its contempt and of subordinate courts. Therefore, the transfer of contempt proceedings from one High Court to another High Court is impermissible, as this would deprive the former court of the jurisdiction vested in it by the Constitution. This power is similar in content, scope, and nature to the corresponding power of the Supreme Court and is governed by analogous considerations. Accordingly, High Courts need to exercise the jurisdiction sparingly, observing extreme care, caution, and circumspection, and confine themselves to the question of compliance only. They can take cognizance either sua moto or upon an application by a party. By virtue of being a superior court of record, a high court possesses the inherent power and duty of review as a safeguard against the miscarriage of justice, to ensure that their record is devoid of any grave or apparent errors and is in accordance with law. The second important jurisdiction is its writ jurisdiction under Article 226. Article 226 confers an extraordinary and special jurisdiction on high courts to issue writs, orders, or directions. The provision extends the pre-constitution grant, which was limited to the high courts of Bombay, Calcutta, and Madras, to all high courts. Similar to Article 32 in its nature, Article 226 provides an important mechanism for judicial review of administrative, legislative, and governmental action or non-action. Clause 1 specifies the writs high courts which may issue, which are mandamus, certiorari, prohibition, quo warranto and habeas corpus. The jurisdiction under Article 226 is parallel to and independent of the jurisdiction under Article 32. In other words, the jurisdiction of high courts is not in derogation of the Supreme Court's jurisdiction. A self-imposed policy limitation to this jurisdiction is the alternative efficacious remedy rule. That is, when an alternative and equally efficacious remedy is available to a litigant, he should pursue that remedy first. While high courts are not bound by this rule, the existence of an adequate legal remedy needs to be taken into consideration. For example, when a statute stipulates remedies, recourse should first be taken to this remedy and not to a writ petition. A critical difference between both provisions is that while Article 32 is restricted to the violation of fundamental rights, Article 226 empowers high courts to grant relief for the enforcement of any fundamental right or for any other purpose, as mentioned in Clause 1, thus covering even legal rights. The practical implication of this difference is that person or authority in Article 226 has been interpreted broadly. The term authority is also used in Article 12, and the question often raised before courts was whether the term authority in Article 226 ought to be interpreted in the same narrow sense as in Article 12 or more broadly than that. The position is that Article 12 is only relevant for Article 32 since the latter is restricted to enforcing fundamental rights. Therefore, under Article 226, writs may be issued to bodies which are not instrumentalities of the state. They may cover any person or body performing a public duty or function. The nature of the body matters, not the form of the body. Writ jurisdiction is supervisory and not appellate in nature, the primary purpose of which is to enable high courts to judicially review the decision-making process rather than the decision itself. Therefore, high courts are usually reluctant to delve into questions of fact. However, the decision to enter into such an inquiry falls within the realm of their discretion. Like the Supreme Court under Article 32, even high courts have employed Article 226 as a means to provide justice to weaker sections of society, thereby exercising discretion to mold reliefs and liberalize locus standi. High courts too have infused a remedial aspect into the provision by awarding compensation or damages. While the rules of available alternative remedies and exhaustion of local remedies are not inflexible, res judicata and laches have operated as self-imposed limitations to this jurisdiction. Another important jurisdiction of the High Court is its superintending jurisdiction under Article 227. Article 227 confers the power of superintendence on high courts over all courts and tribunals within the territorial jurisdiction to ensure that the latter act within the bounds of their authority and according to law. The coverage of tribunals is significant given their proliferation in recent times. The power extends to judicial and administrative matters and can be exercised sua motu by high courts in the interest of justice, even after a decision is declared to be final and conclusive. It needs to be exercised sparingly and not for correcting mere errors of law or fact. High courts will not interfere when a court or tribunal has acted within its jurisdiction unless any grave miscarriage of justice or flagrant violation of law has been committed. Further, high courts would normally not reappreciate, review, or reweigh evidence after the same has been appreciated and questions of fact decided, unless the substantial portion of evidence relied upon suffers from serious infirmities or if any finding of fact is not supported by conclusive evidence. As regards the relationship between Articles 226 and 227, an intra-court appeal from a single judge to a division bench is possible in Article 226 proceedings as proceedings fall on the original side, which is not the case for Article 227. Since there are many situations where a petition can be filed under both provisions, the practice is to treat a petition as having been filed under Article 226 to protect the petitioner's remedy of an intra-court appeal. The next important jurisdiction of the High Court is the constitutional question jurisdiction under Article 228. Article 228 allows the High Court to withdraw a case pending in a subordinate court if it is satisfied that the case involves a substantial question of law regarding the interpretation of the Constitution, provided the determination of the question is necessary to dispose the case. The High Court may either dispose the whole case itself or only determine the constitutional question and return the case to the subordinate court for disposal in conformity with the High Court's determination. The provision enables the High Court to determine the constitutional question at the earliest opportunity. The language of Article 228 is such that once the conditions mentioned therein are satisfied, the High Court is required to withdraw the case for itself. The second rank in the state judiciary is a subordinate judiciary. Every state has a system of subordinate courts below the High Courts. Articles 233 to 237 regulate the organization and guarantee the independence and integrity of subordinate courts, which is very important since it is in this segment in which the judiciary comes in close contact with the people. Accordingly, these provisions have been interpreted to strengthen the control of high courts and weaken executive control on the subordinate judiciary. Further, both the Supreme Court and High Courts have assumed power to punish for the contempt of subordinate courts. The structure of the subordinate judiciary is different for civil courts and criminal courts and varies between metropolitan or city areas and districts. For example, some of the civil courts in metropolitan areas include the Court of Small Causes, the City Civil Court, and the High Court, whereas in districts, the courts you will find are the district judge, the civil judge senior division, followed by the civil judge junior division. For criminal courts, in cities or metropolitan areas, some of the courts found are the Sessions Court, followed by the Court of Chief Metropolitan Magistrate, followed by the courts of metropolitan magistrates, whereas in districts, the structure consists of Sessions Courts, followed by the Court of Chief Judicial Magistrate, followed by the Courts of Judicial Magistrates of First Class and of Second Class. There are limitations on the sentences which can be passed by the different criminal courts. For example, a Sessions Judge can pass any sentence authorized by law. However, any death sentence is subject to confirmation by the High Court. The Chief Judicial Magistrate can pass any sentence authorized by law except a death sentence or of life imprisonment or of imprisonment exceeding 7 years. Like this, there are limitations and restrictions on the different sentences which can be passed by the different criminal courts. The third rung in the state judiciary is tribunals. Articles 323A and 323B have aided the proliferation of tribunals, which have emerged as an integral component of the judicial system in India. A tribunal is typically a quasi-judicial body which is constituted by and conferred inherent judicial power to adjudicate disputes by the state, thereby having some trappings of a court. Both provisions are enabling in nature, providing the necessary constitutional sanction for any legislation creating tribunals. In addition, the provisions expressly safeguard the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court under Article 136. However, while both allow for the legislation to exclude the jurisdiction of high courts in matters falling within the jurisdiction of tribunals, the Supreme Court ruled in L. Chandra Kumar v. Union of India that the jurisdiction under Articles 226 and 227 cannot be taken away since it is part of the inviolable basic structure of the Constitution. Therefore, all decisions of tribunals created under Article 323A or 323B are subject to writ jurisdiction under Articles 226 and 227. The Supreme Court has clarified that the power of Parliament to establish a tribunal for any matter not covered by Articles 323A and 323B is intact and protected under List 1 and its residuary powers. In September 2014, a 5-judge constitution bench of the Supreme Court struck down the National Tax Tribunal Act 2005 as unconstitutional on the grounds that it encroached upon the exclusive domain of the Superior Courts of Record and the principle of separation of powers. The statute envisaged the creation of a National Tax Tribunal, or the NTT. The NTT would deal with and expedite the settlement of tax-related matters of high courts, thereby taking away the jurisdiction of high courts in this respect. The entity never came into being since the validity of the Act was challenged for suffering from excessive executive control and for allowing the entity to decide substantial questions of law. While the Supreme Court upheld the power of Parliament to create tribunals, it held that tribunals must have the trappings of a court. The court held that the basic structure of the Constitution will be violated if, while enacting legislation pertaining to transfer of judicial power, Parliament does not ensure that the newly created court or tribunal conforms with the salient characteristics and standards of the court sought to be substituted. A tribunal cannot substitute the high courts in their appellate jurisdiction when it comes to deciding substantial questions of law. Accordingly, the court noted that the statute empowered the entity to lay down the law of the land, which would be binding on all authorities and tribunals. This is a direct encroachment on the jurisdiction of high courts to decide substantial questions of law, which would bind all tribunals.